So 2019, the year to reign. God is calling us to reign over our 2019. Reign over your 2K19. As we heard it, it's more than just mere words, but it's reality. I want you to shout, we reign.
We reign.
Shout,
we reign.
From the beginning, mankind was created to reign. From the beginning, mankind was created to reign. We were created to have dominion over creation. That's man's original plan, and God's original plan for man was to have dominion over all creation. That's found in Genesis 1. And reigning with Christ is our ultimate end that he envisioned in Revelation 22. So God, the author and finisher of our faith, started with man's road to reigning. Man fell. Jesus reigned so that we can reign with him. Reigning is throughout the scripture. And when God showed me this, I said, I didn't think about it. But from the beginning, we were called to have dominion. We were called to walk in what God has called us to walk in. As we learned on New Year's Eve during the watch night service, the word reign is defined as to hold the royal office, to have dominion, to have power, to have authority, to have possessions, to be superior, to prevail, to conquer, and to win. In kingdoms, right? So in kingdoms and in the kingdom, there's, in the natural kingdom, there's three different higher ranking officials in essence. So we got the first one, right? We got the Duke and Duchess, right? It's a smaller chair, smaller thing for them to reign over, a smaller territory for them to reign over, right? Then you have the prince and the princess. Now their territory does what? It expands a little bit more, right? And it oversees the Duke and the Duchess territory. But then we have the King and the Queen. The King and the Queen oversee the Prince and the Princess's territory, which also oversees the entire territory of the Duchess, of the Duke and the Duchess. So therefore, when our King reigns, he's calling a call to action to reign over every territory of our life. Over every territory of our life. Our King reigns, he whose hair is white as wool, whose feet are as brass, whose train fills the temple, whose voice sounds like the rushing mighty wind. He reigns. He reigns. Shout this with me. My King Jesus reigns.
My King Jesus reigns.
I don't have a white flag, but let's all be colorblind in the natural for a second. Here I have a purple flag. Let's pretend it's white. In 2019, God is calling us to wave our white flag. The waving of a white flag in war symbolizes two things. One is that a negotiator is coming to talk about what's going to take place. The individual waving the white flag at that point cannot be shot at. They're coming for one reason and one reason only: to negotiate peace, or to try to bring about a different structure in that battle. But another thing that waving the right flag does is a call to surrender. In 2019, God is calling us to wave our white flags and surrender it all to him. Because once we put ourselves aside and we surrender it all to Him, He will have His way in us. Surrender every aspect of your life to Him in 2019 and watch and see what He does. That was my call to action this year. Is person to surrender it all to Him. Nothing belongs to me. And so far, so good. So far, so good. But it's not just so far, so good. Because it's a 2019 thing. It's a 2020 thing. It's not just the 1 week into 2019 thing. This is for the long haul.
Yes.
What the Lord is doing now is for the long haul. So in 2019, God is calling us to wave our white flags. As we said, the white flag symbolizes negotiation. The white flag ultimately signifies surrender and a desire. Listen to this. A desire to communicate. When we have a desire to communicate with the Lord, we've allowed Him dominion, we've allowed Him power, we've allowed Him to stand in the authority that He was called to stand in. So that in return, we can walk in the same authority that He's called us to walk in way back in Genesis 1. Wave your white flag. In order to reign, there's something that we must not do. So we're going to start with the what not to do first. Because the what to do and how to do it outweigh the what not to do. But we cannot do one if we do the other. If we do the other, we cannot do the one. So the first one, if you can turn in your Bibles with me, to 1 Samuel chapter 13. We're going to actually start in verse number 8. So it says, then he waited 7 days according to the time set by Samuel. So here, Samuel told Saul, you go into battle. Obviously, the Lord is going to have His way. You're going to reign. But don't do anything within 7 days. Wait till I show up. Wait till I show up. So that's a little context. So then he says, but Samuel did not come to Gilgal, and the people were scattered from him. So Saul said, bring a burnt offering and a peace offering here to me. And he offered the burnt offering. Now it happened, as soon as he had finished presenting the burnt offering, that Samuel came. What happens and what we need to avoid is for us to do things that we desire to be done prematurely, out of God's will. Right? So we need to be obedient. Be obedient. So Saul said, bring the burnt offering, right? Now it happened, as soon as he brought it and presented the burnt offering, Samuel showed up. Saul went out to meet him, that he might greet him. So he thought, hey, I did what you were told. We won the battle, right? I waited the 7 days. So he's waiting to get a big old hug, like, hey, we did this together, right? But this is what happens here. And Samuel said, what have you done? Saul said, when I saw that the people were scattered from me and that you did not come within the days appointed, then I said, so the days appointed, and that the Philistines gathered together, then I said, the Philistines will now come down on me at Gilgal, and I have not made supplications to the Lord. So here, the Lord already delivered him. He allowed him to reign. But what happened was he got scared. He didn't know what was to come next. So he acted out of the will of God. And instead of being obedient, was disobedient. So in 2019, God is calling us to be responsible with the words spoken to us. To be responsible, in essence, unlike Saul, who was disrespectful, right, and unresponsible, we need to be responsible for the office that he's called us to walk in. God is calling us to be obedient to his word. One way not to reign is to walk according to your will and not God's. But we say in this house, not in this house. Not in this house. Amen?
Amen.
Remember, in order for us to reign, we have to let God take the reins of us and walk in obedience. God wants us to wait on him for every move. Saul was given instructions. 7 days. So in his mind, he was what? Justified, right? But he didn't listen. And he didn't wait on God. He didn't wait on the man of God. He didn't wait on what God had planned for him. Psalms 146, verse number 5. You can turn there with me. Psalms 146, 5. So happy is he who has the God of Jacob for his help, whose hope is in the Lord, who made heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in it. Everything that we were created to reign over in Genesis 1. Who keeps truth forever. Who executes justice over the oppressed. So who reigns over injustice. Who gives food to the hungry. Who reigns over hunger. The Lord who gives freedom to the prisoner. The Lord who reigns over captivity. The Lord who opens up the eyes of the blind. The Lord who reigns over the need for physical healing. The Lord who reigns or who raises those who are bowed down. Who reigns over those who are defeated. The Lord loves the righteous. The Lord watches over the strangers. So God is watching over the strangers. Those loved ones that are estranged from him. Those neighbors that we have yet to speak to. God watches over them. He reigns over the fatherless. He reigns over the widows. But the way of the wicked, he turns upside down. The way of the wicked, he turns upside down. So he even reigns over the wicked. And verse number 10, the Lord shall reign forever. Your God, O Zion, to all generations, praise the Lord. God will reign for all generations. God has us covered. God has the previous generation covered. God has this generation covered. God has the generation that's coming covered. God has the generation after that that's coming covered. Then a gentleman. We're not going to read, we're not going to turn. We know the story for the majority of us. The Bible, children's church story, right? One of my favorite ones, David and Goliath. 1 Samuel 17 is where it can be found. So David was willing to step out in faith and conquer. One of the definitions for the word reign is to conquer. So David was willing to listen to the voice of the Lord, which Saul did not, and was able to step out in faith and conquer. So David stepped out in faith so that the Lord in him can reign. He was willing to do what the others were afraid to do. In 2019, God is calling us to do what others are afraid to do. When we do what others are afraid to do, watch and see what the doer does. Because if the doer is waiting for us to step out in faith, and we do it, the doer knows what to do. And with the doer doing what the doer does, I want you to repeat that. I'm just kidding. Right? With the doer doing what the doer does, those doing what the doer desires for them to do are going to do way more in 2019 than the doers did in previous years before that. But the doers need to listen to the doer that gives direction. Because if we listen and we walk according to what the doer has designed for us to do, we will watch and see the blessings that come upon our lives. Because in reigning, thank you, Lord. When someone reigns, they don't have un poquito. They don't have un poquito mucho. Right? They don't have un poquito mucho mucho. When the reigners reign, they oversee everything. So that means that everything that God has desired for us to have, when we do what the doer desires for us to do, we get what the doer has for us. Amen? Amen. The Lord and David reigned over Goliath. The Lord and David reigned over Goliath and the Philistines. If he reigned over Goliath, he will reign over every giant that tries to pop his ugly head in our lives in 2019. I almost brought, I'm glad I left it at home. Because for those of you guys that know the story, David, once he knocked them out, he grabbed his own sword. The thing that was meant to kill him. He grabbed his own sword and decapitated him. I was going to bring my wig from the Jesus with the wig stand and kind of just show it, but I thought that would have been awkward. So I didn't do that. I'm serious. I was going to do it. I'm glad I did not. Because every time I look at that thing, I'm like, ooh. It's like, ooh. Every time I see a picture, like, ooh, that boy needs a haircut. Jesus, Jesus, you need a haircut, right? So he took his own sword, and then what he did, he reigned over all the Philistines and said, nah, 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 look what I got. And then what happened? What happened? Israel saw what took place. What took place? And they said, now it's time to go. Now it's time to go. And 2019, now is our time to reign, but now is our time to go and do what God is calling us to do. The call to action is real simple. And it's something that apostles said from the pulpit that we're lacking in. The call to action is simple. The call to action is found, as we know, in the Great Commission. Go. Go into all the world and make disciples, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Because now we went, we discipled somebody, Now they get what we got. They reign like we reign. And now they get the call to action. And now they go. I'm going to stop moving. And now they go. And now they go. And the same thing happens over and over and over. Because we understand that reigning is a big part of the plan and the purpose that God has for our lives. I was doing some basketball games yesterday, and it's a Christian outreach league that I ref in. And before the games, they have a devotional. Real quick, right before the game, 2 to 5 minutes. The question was asked, what's your purpose? Why are you here? Well, I'm here to play basketball. I'm here to win. My partner, who's also a believer, we looked at each other and he said, that's a very good question. And I said, yes, that is a very good question. We don't expect a high schooler to answer that question because in some cases, adults in the church don't even know. Our job is for us to understand that Genesis 1 says that we have dominion. So therefore, what's our purpose? Our purpose is to reign in the purpose that God has for us. And that is the plan and purpose that He has for your life. That may be in the vocational. That may be in full-time ministry. That may be in whatever God has desired for you to walk that path in. But the thing is, that's the one thing that even for a lot of adults, they still don't understand. But our purpose here on earth is to do exactly what the Great Commission says. Is to make disciples, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. And now we do that and it happens again and again. That's our purpose. Our purpose is to be Christ with skin. Our purpose is to do what God is calling us to do. Amen? Amen. This story is interesting because I never seen it from this angle. Turn with me to Matthew chapter 8. We're going to start with verse number 5. It says, now when Jesus had entered Capernaum, a centurion came to him, pleading with him, begging him, saying, Lord, my servant is lying at home, paralyzed, dreadfully tormented. And Jesus said to him, I will come and heal him. So Jesus said, I will come. So therefore, Jesus put a little more emphasis on the situation and said, I'm going to take my time to get over there, right? To walk over there and do what you've asked me to do. Because he saw something in him. So then the rest of the scripture says this. It says, and Jesus said to him, I will come and heal him. The centurion answered and said, Lord, I am not worthy that you should come under my roof, but only speak a word, and my servant will be healed. For I know I also am a man under authority, having soldiers under me. I say to them, go, and he goes. I say to them, come, and he comes. And my servant does this, and he does it well. Jesus was amazed at the centurion's faith. He said, truly, I have not found anyone in Israel with such faith. The evidence of this faith came because the centurion believed that Jesus' words reigned and were sufficient enough to heal the servant. So Jesus' words alone were sufficient enough because his words reigned. And listen to this. Let's look at the reason why it was so easy for him to believe. One of the definitions of reign is to possess power or authority, right? So the centurion realized that as in the army in which he was in, authority comes from being under authority. So Jesus' authority comes from being under the authority of his Father. So the centurion saw that when Jesus spoke, God also spoke. When Jesus spoke, God spoke. And because he understood authority, and the man of God spoke, it was to him as if God was speaking. So he was under authority and he understood authority. Let's go to Romans 5:17. Romans 5:17. So as we heard, the purpose of man and the original intent of mankind was to reign and to have dominion over all creation, right? As we heard, we learned, and we know. And we also learned that the end result is us reigning with Christ. So he started the book the same way he ends the book. Chapter 5 of Romans 17 says this: "For if by one man's offense death reigned, through one, much more, those who receive abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness will reign in life through one, Jesus Christ." So as we heard on New Year's Eve, this is a gift that was handed to us. I heard that the days after Christmas, I think for about a month or two, there was some crazy number, about $9 billion worth of gifts that were given would be exchanged within that time period. Or gifts that were given, it could be that Christmas tie that, you know, you only wear once a year, whatever the case is, right? Or that crock pot that's cracked, right? Because maybe it was shipped wrong and it broke, right? So crazy, outrageous number of gifts that will be returned back within a month or two or something like that of Christmas. But this gift that was given to us is not a gift that we deserved. It's not a gift that can be returned. It's not a gift that should be played with. It's not a gift that should be, you know, that we can sit in front of our TV and just sit there for hours and be on our little handheld video game system and just play for hours. No, this gift that was given was a gift given to us of action. Yes. This free gift that was given to us is a gift that says, "Hey, here, son, this is for you. Go. Run with it. Let's not, well, this is a gift of grace and righteousness that allows me to reign. Let me go ahead and just put this back here. Let me pull it out when I need it." It's not what God is calling us. That's not how we reign. This is a gift that was freely given. This is a gift that was freely given. This is a gift that we freely give unto others. We freely give unto others. And as we give that gift unto others, what happens? Now something within us starts to ignite. A fire within us starts to brew. And we start to see and look at things differently because we're reigning. We're reigning. We're seeing a little bit further than we did in 2018. Right? Where maybe our vision was front row vision. 2018, maybe our vision was second row vision. But 2019, God is looking us to look down to see what he desires.
Yeah.
Oh, Lord, that's a mile away. I can see that vision. Oh, Lord, woo, that's 2 miles away, Lord. I can see that vision. Lord, I never seen that far before. Why? Because we're reigning over the big chair. We're not reigning over the little chair. Our season of sleep, our season of slumber, that season's over with. That season's gone. The season of sleep and slumber, that's no more. God is calling us to see. Have vision to see things that we didn't see in 2018. That's reigning. When we see things from the mountaintop. We can't see anything from the valleys. We learn a lot in the valleys. The valley's the time of learning, right? But when we climb up, when we climb up when we're sick, and we climb up and we're reigning over sickness. When we're not feeling well, there's drama in our marriage. We're learning in that drama, right? But we're over. I'm seeing beyond the drama. I'm seeing beyond my circumstance. We're seeing beyond our situation. That's when we reign. We're truly reigning when we're seeing beyond what's in front of us. And beyond what's in front of us is somebody else. What's beyond what's in front of us is somebody else. We have people in front of us that we see and we make contact with. And we can engage and we can introduce to the Lord. But when we do that, we don't know the beyond what's in front of us. That's when we reign. God is calling us to just take it to the next level. Reigning is taking it to the next level. Reigning is taking it to the next level. Do not take advantage of this gift of grace. It was a free gift. Do not walk in self-righteousness. Have a spiritual know-it-all attitude. Right? This gift was given. It was given to us. The handoff was made. The exchange was made. It was given to us with good intentions, right? And it's intended to be used with good intentions. Because we are in Christ, and Christ is in us, we get to walk in God's free gift of grace and righteousness that leads to Him reigning over our lives. Amen?
Amen.
In 2019, let's allow Him to continue to reign over every aspect of our life. Over every aspect of our life. Every aspect of our life. Those mentioned in a little bit, and those not mentioned. When I say He, I want you to shout, reigns. He
reigns
over our finances. He
reigns
over our schedules. He
reigns
over our family. He
reigns
over our marriage. He
reigns
over our job. He
reigns
over our ministry. He
reigns
over our prayer life. He
reigns
over our devotions. He
reigns
over our desires. He
reigns.
We may never take control of our lives and rule over every circumstance on our own strength. But I submit to you today that we can and will reign as kings and queens in this life. 1 Peter 2:9, one of my favorite scriptures. But you are a chosen generation.
Yes.
You are a royal priesthood. You are a holy nation, his own special people, that you may proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness into the marvelous light. He, as a result, we will walk in victory over every situation. 1 John says this: for whatever is born of God. Are we born of God?
Yes.
Are we a whatever in this situation? Right? For whatever is born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that has come and overcome the world. Our faith. Our faith. Let's all stand.
Father, we just thank you for this day, Lord.
Yes.
We thank you, Lord, for the word that went forth, Father God, on New Year's Eve, Father God, that has launched us into what you desire for us to have in 2019. And what you desire for us to have in 2019 is that we, Lord, will reign in the victory that you've called us to reign in, Lord.
Amen.
And we thank you for that.
Amen.
In Jesus' name.
Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Love you guys. God bless you guys.